My name is Stephanie Todd Wong. I'm the Director of Performing Arts and Culture here at Asia Society Texas Center. And on behalf of our board and staff, I'd like to welcome you here this evening for a conversation on representation and 21st century responsibilities in the performing arts. As a Caucasian female in a position of determining which performing arts programs we present here, I am very aware of the difficult nature of this topic. Whitewashing, yellowface, cultural appropriation, these are extremely difficult and sensitive issues with no clear-cut or simple solutions. As our dialogue tonight is likely to challenge our assumptions, we expect at times it will be uncomfortable and request that we all approach one another respectfully and leave ourselves open to hearing different points of view. I'm heartened by the size of this audience and having you all here with us tonight, and want to commend you for your willingness to engage in a difficult conversation. We have the opportunities to support one another as we grapple with these issues, and I feel privileged to be a part of a community that's willing to tackle it head on. With this in mind, please know that this is the first of what we hope will be many conversations. Another community dialogue is scheduled for the fall, and it'll be hosted by the Ensemble Theater, and we hope that you'll keep that in mind and look for the details as they become available. And I've talked enough, because I don't like to do this part. So, just very quickly, because our ability to host this program wouldn't be possible without all of our donors and sponsors, I'd like to direct you to the back of our program and just acknowledge them and thank them very quickly. I also really need to send out a truly heartfelt thanks to our partners this evening, the Houston Grand Opera, University of Houston Center for Arts and Social Engagement, and OCA of Greater Houston. Without them being willing to engage in this conversation with me, we wouldn't be here this evening. So if you haven't yet silenced your phone, now would be a great time. And I'd like to welcome our panelists to the stage. First is Ryan Speedo Green, bass baritone. Next is Pia Agrawal. She's the program director of the University of Houston Cynthia Woods Mitchell Center for the Arts. Patrick Summers is our artistic and music director of Houston Grand Opera. Shuwei Chen, composer and department chair of composition and professor at the Shepherd School of Music at Rice University. And Stephen Wu, co-director of the Houston Asian American Pacific Islander Film Festival. And then my dear friend and our moderator for the evening, Sixto Wagon, inaugural chair of the Center for the Arts and Social Engagement at University of Houston. And now I get to walk away and they get to engage in a very lively conversation. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you, Asia Society, HGO. Thank you, HowlRound, who's live streaming this right now. I want to just give a little bit of framework as to what our conversation this evening. Part of this is the question is, like, if art is a mirror to society, how much of that mirror reflect our current demographics? What is our responsibility? And this evening is not a debate. No one wins, no one loses. This is a conversation, this is a dialogue, and this is discourse. We don't want to, I feel that we're all winning already because performing arts has actually sparked a vital and discourse. And a lot of people here through internet and also here tonight have actually been passionate about this conversation. And that's really what art is about, I think. And I'm grateful for that. Tonight we're focusing on an Asian lens. These issues are through many other aspects of any minority can actually be talking about these issues. But tonight we felt is really important in order to talk and address an Asian lens, because part of the discourse here in Houston has very much been about an African-American and white lens, or Latino and white. Rarely has the Asian voice been part of that. Tonight, we're going to at least start part of that conversation. Part of what we're also going to be talking about is intention versus reception. What is the intention of the artist, and what is the reception, and how is it received by the audience? At some point, there's a disconnect. When it works, it's incredible. And part of our conversation tonight, we'll actually start with that. So let me give you some current our operating definitions for yellowface and whitewashing. Yellowface means more than a white person wearing makeup to look Asian, typical slanty eyes and yellow skin. It also describes the systematic propagation of racist Asian stereotypes and caricatures. In its simplest form, whitewashing refers to the tendency of media and society to look at everything through a white experience. The stories are dominated by white characters, played by white actors, navigating a story that will likely resonate most deeply with white audiences. That the assumed way of working through the world is from a white perspective, and that the color doesn't matter. And that humanness is universal. So, Stephen, yes. I want to start with, do those definitions actually resonate with you? Or how do you, and can you actually give any examples of what that might be?
Sure, I mean, those are beautiful examples, and I generally agree with what those definitions mean for those two terms. Many people think of whitewashing as just having a white actor or a non-Asian actor for a Asian-specific role, but it can also, to me at least, refer to that person playing in a role where the story or narrative is more Asian-centric. I think of a recent film like The Great Wall, where Matt Damon is the main character in fictional China, and they're fighting monsters. It's not a real historical reference at all. However, there is, it's a bit odd to see a white lead role come in to save the day, quote unquote, from these monsters in China. And to me, that has two effects on people. One is for non-Asians generally, and then secondly to younger Asian American children. So for the group, the non-Asian groups, it's if you don't necessarily meet or interact with a lot of Asian Americans regularly, media unfortunately can shape your world and your perceptions, and that becomes normal for you. So that when you go and actually meet people, that is your thought, that is what you think these people could be, and incorrectly so sometimes. On the other hand, for children, I mean, when you're a young Asian American kid and you're going to the movie theaters and you're seeing all these great Marvel, we were talking about Marvel films recently, and if you don't see someone that looks like you playing the lead role, I mean, that has an effect on you. I mean, personally, for me, it did for some time. Like, I don't know why I'm not that person on stage, on screen, saving the day necessarily. I always use Jeremy Lin as my example. Loved basketball, saw him play in the NBA, and I was like, man, I could maybe, cross my fingers, be in the NBA one day. So it has profound effects beyond just the audience watching that day, but also everyone that they interact with in society as a whole.
And I think it's interesting because it is about a representational power.
Yes.
And the power of it when it happens, and the systematic, when it hasn't been happening systematically, where are we left with? So I think that is a broader context and popular culture, and we'll most likely get back to that conversation. One of the things that we want to focus particularly on today is about the performing arts, and really, what is our role, and what is the power of live performance, and what is our responsibility? And so, Patrick, I think that part of this was sparked by Nixon in China and those mm-hmm. conversations, mm-hmm. so I think that it'd be great in order for you to tell us a little bit about your reaction to the controversy, and also and how does cultural representation inform or conflict with practical realities of actually being an artistic director?
Well, in the operatic field, we do at Houston Grand Opera a relatively large amount of new work compared to many opera companies, but it's still a small amount of our total repertoire. We're still dealing with a repertoire that is, in the case of the regular Mozart operas, is a couple of hundred years old, and deal with a very different set of cultural sensibilities, and we have to figure out ways to perform them that are both sensitive to the cultural times now, but are also sensitive to Mozart and to the original intentions of these older operas, and that's very, very challenging. If we did only new operas, these issues would not really be present, because we could easily make all of our new operas reflect the cultural realities of now. but opera is a field that deals in extraordinary degrees of difficulty. I'm rehearsing an opera right now, Götterdämmerung, for which there are fewer than two or three people in the world who can sing any one of those major roles. And there are probably, we imagine there are probably fewer than 400 professional opera singers in the world who are regularly making a sustained living being an opera singer. So many, many thousands of singers try, and Ryan can certainly speak to this. Ryan's an extraordinarily gifted opera singer, but there are a lot of those, and they don't all make a career. It's an extraordinarily competitive field in which to exist. So,
and I think whether we get to it right now or a little bit, I think well, actually, let's talk about it now in terms of skill. You talked about skill and that. What is that pipeline and how? And really, part of the conversation that you brought up is that you have been doing your work in HAO Studio in order to try to develop that. But
in miniature, a pipeline would be a talented, in terms of singing, a talented singer at age 18 would audition for a university vocal program, spend 4 years on a bachelor's degree, and then 2 years on a master's degree. That would be a pretty normal path, and then spend 2 or 3 years in an apprentice program like Houston Grand Opera Studio or the Vienna State Opera Ensemble, where Ryan is right now. And then, after that nearly decade of training, then they enter a field which is extraordinarily competitive, and there will be even fewer of them at that point that make a career. So it's, and for the studio, for the Houston Grand Opera Studio, I think the number was 430 some applicants this year, for the Concert of Arias competition, of which 20 semifinalists came to Houston, 10 participated in Concert of Arias, and 4 were invited. How many?
3
were invited into the studio out of that initial group of 430. And that's a normal degree of competitiveness. That's not abnormal at all.
So you talked about the choice to, you know, if you're able to make new work.
Yeah.
And I think one of the things that actually, well, let's go to Pia, with, as the program director at the Mitchell, Cynthia Woods Mitchell Center for the Arts, that's pretty much all you present is new work.
Yes, and I think we are, you know, we're in a very different position in doing new work, contemporary work, where, you know, the training process is less vigorous. Even if we're doing work on stage, it's not, you know, it's not as filtered as the experience that you have of being that competitive. But I think the opportunity to present new work has allowed me to find projects where artists are telling their own stories. I think that's felt really important. And I think if I compare, I've been doing festival work for about 12 years, compare my experience now to my experience about 10 years ago. You know, 10 years ago, the work that I was producing was largely white European work. And so that has evolved as more social conversations have evolved with an attempt to represent the world around us a bit more. I think, you know, when I think more specifically about examples within the Southeast Asian community, the thing that strikes me about representation in the performing arts and on stage is that, in my experience, the most successful Southeast Asian performers who've gone to tour or work more globally are often in projects or in situations where their Asianness is juxtaposed against whiteness. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of like dance duets that have traditional Indian dance juxtaposed with Western dance in a way that it feels like, and you know, again, 10 years ago, I may not be saying these same things, but now in thinking about it, it feels that the value in that work is against whiteness on its own. It doesn't stand the same way as on its own. It's not for a diverse audience on its own. Indian dance is for an Indian audience. Mm-hmm. But if you put a white European dancer in there and they have a cultural, you know, exchange, it becomes a more global conversation, and that's a really that's where I'm at, that sort of difficult spot.
I guess I'm just trying to parse that up. So I think that you said that it becomes a global conversation because whiteness is on stage and therefore it is more acceptable?
I think acceptable is a tricky word. It's not maybe the word that would come out of my mouth, but I think it becomes more accessible is maybe, you know, and not, and I don't necessarily use that word in a positive way. I think the accessibility comes from, you know, Asianness or brownness being qualified by whiteness in that situation. When you put, you know, you put a white body on stage with a brown body, with an Asian body, an Indian body, it's the white body that's defining the reason that brown body is on stage. You know, and that's a pretty specific example that I've seen a lot in dance, but I think I've seen, you know, in going into, going back to the definition of whitewashing, I think the issues around characters being represented by cliches, you know, you're working less with characters in a form like dance, or in my experience, the work I produce is less character-based, but there are hints of that. There are hints of the definition of an Indian role being very defined by tradition, by traditional Indian dance, not by any sort of evolved art form. And of course, you know, that person is trained. They are on stage. They are doing that work. But I think in turning it into opportunity, success, that is the work that I've seen that's had the most success, the most response, the most press, the most praise.
So I just kind of, I'm hearing there's aspects of what are the change of standards in terms of aesthetics and what can be presented, and then also tradition in terms of what has been traditional and how are we actually thinking about tradition in a contemporary aspect. I think that part of what we want to do is that we're giving a part of an organizational and institutional approach right now, and then actually I want to come now bring artists into this and hear from them. So Speedo, as a singer and accomplished singer, who's been involved in some of the controversy, how was that to embody a controversial figure in Death of King Arthur?
Well, recently, I was in a production at the Metropolitan Opera by the same composer, John Adams, who did Nixon in China, and the opera was called Death of Klinghoffer. And I don't know if you guys were watching the news about 2 years ago, it was all over the news, international news, and you could see my face with the machine gun. And I played, the opera's about a group of terrorists who take over an Italian cruise ship with American tourists on it, and they end up killing, it's based off a true story, and they end up killing an American Jewish man and in a wheelchair, murdering him and throwing him overboard. I played one of the three terrorists, and my my part, I had an aria, and in this aria, for about 3.5 to 4 minutes, I basically spewed all of the rhetoric of a person who would be an extremist. Talking about everything from how Jews will deceive you, and you know how American Jews are the worst kind of Jews, and you know these horrible rhetoric that a person who was extremist would say, and so there were huge protests before the opera ever made it to the stage from a lot of the community of New York and from all different angles, especially Jewish organizations, and saying that this opera promoted anti-Semitism and anti-Semitic rhetoric. And fortunately, people came to the opening night and saw the opera, and then we had about a couple thousand people protesting it the day of and the weeks before, and then after opening night, we had nobody protesting. Because basically, when you talk about preconceptions that people have, like how viewers view it and how we perform it, I think it's so important for people before they make judgments about a piece, whether it be a piece about Asian culture or a piece about jihadism and extremism, that they do the research on exactly what the piece is about, what's going on in the piece, because basically the entire audience, including Mayor Giuliani, took my 3.5 minute aria and based that off the and say that and based that as the entire opera, and said that those 3.5 minutes were 2.5 hours of music, and they didn't look at any of the other music or what happened before I said this aria, what happened after I said this aria, what my character was doing, or anything like that. They just took those 3.5 minutes and said that was the opera. And then once people saw it and they realized that that 3.5 minutes were basically me being the evilest human being on the planet, and that the person who I was saying to was this the Jewish man who I would eventually kill, and he beforehand talked about you know, how we should be killing it, you shouldn't be killing us, you shouldn't be killing anybody, what you're doing is wrong, and there are so many elements of this opera that presented terrorism as being bad, and it was giving not only the audience the view of the people who are being assaulted and caused pain by terrorism, but also who were these terrorists? Like, what brought them here? What made them this way? What helped them get to this point where they wanted to have so much hate and pain in them in their hearts? And I think people really responded to it.
So I think that, you know, in this piece, it was a contemporary piece.
Yes.
In a contemporary context, in which everybody was able to understand what the perceptions are and what the actual history was at that moment.
Once they gave it a chance.
It's
20 years old, yes, based off of an event that happened in 1985, I believe.
Yeah, I think the controversial point, and we were talking about the same composer, John Adams, and the controversial point of Nixon in China is largely the second act ballet that Alice Goodman and John chose to put into the story. Largely, Nixon in China is a complete sort of fantasia on a historical event, and it's about how we... The sort of meta plot of the opera is about how we assemble news and how we put, you know, how we put our stories together. But they chose to put an actual event on stage in the second act of Nixon in China, which is the ballet The Red Detachment of Women, which was a Maoist propaganda ballet / Chinese opera that was performed for the Nixons, and it does include very uncomfortable Asian cliches that make the Nixon characters in the opera also very uncomfortable. It's the engine of a lot of change in the two Nixon characters, but and it's a historical fact. It did indeed happen, and so it has a discomfort in the engine of the drama, but it now, of course, also carries a larger...
But I guess in this point is that in that particular situation, it's clear, the way that you have presented it, it's very clear in mm-hmm. terms of the historical...
That's the intention. You wanted to talk about it.
But I think that was the intention,
yeah.
And I think
yeah.
that that's... The intention there is clear. How the audience and perceives it, receives it, and understands that is part of where we're having where all this controversy lies, and really where do we need to be? And I think that as much as you say that, there are parts of that where I agree with you and I understand, and there are parts of it that I'm like, well, why did you choose that in particular? Why did you choose that way? What are the other ways? And so some of these choices are really part of, I guess, I'm going to just transition to choices and to Shiwei and artists, and we'll get everybody to speak on the panel, and then we can kind of come back to this. So I guess, Shiwei, as an artist, and the choices that you are making, and these ideas about representation, does this challenge or does this inform the work that you're doing?
Yeah. So I'm just looking among the panels here. I guess I am the only one that's an international student and immigrant here. I've been in this country for 30 years. But nevertheless, I was born in Taiwan. So I see a very different aspect of this point of view, because I think the fact we can sit here and discuss this issue is really remarkable, because I could not imagine this kind of thing would be discussed in Taipei or in Shanghai, for example, because everybody is the same way. Most likely, there's no big issue about it, right? So I want to bring it up, and I think it's really wonderful, because in my mind, I think that to deal with race and gender issue, I mean, the States has been really an important forerunner in the rest of the world. And back to the idea of the choice. Before that, I want to say, I think acknowledging it's important to bring up Asian, you know, to have a correctness, to have Asian or gender, but I think nobody want to be think that you win this award or you were casting in this play because you were Asian,
right,
because you were female, because I think good art should not be analysis from some boundary. But having said that, that's a less problem for me if I was seeing a black face portray an Asian father, for example. But for me, it is particularly the choice of is this not a timing, it's not right. You know, it's 70, in the 70s, it's okay to talk about, to portray this story. The red detachment, the woman, and within the woman,
right,
on the stage. I think that's it's not a good choice to put it in there. And so I feel the time is so different now. And you know, on the other hand, because we have so many bigger population, Asian population right now, and also we have to be sensitive to see these populations. If we want to reach the story, not only to the Asian audience, but to a broader audience, we want to see the person sitting in there, how would they feel? How would they feel when they see that? And then the younger audience, how would they feel when they see that? Oh, that's what Asia is like. But that's not true, not at all, because Asia is really much, much more advanced than we think. I feel like if we have, we can come, like in recent days, that the opera has been modernized, like Peter Sellers making the Mozart or Wagner, making it more modernized so that the audience can feel more relate to it, as a relative. And so this is the chance that we can maybe find a way to adapt that. And so, and not only casting a more Asian audience, Asian cast players, performers, but maybe in the production, you could include some Asian specialists. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I mean, you have Asian Society, and you have Rice University, you have Sixto, right? And you have Pia, like today, we have all this conversation. If we include this conversation and say, well, we were gonna do this, what do you think? And you would say, oh, I don't think so. You know, I don't wanna see that. I don't think that's appropriate. And I think that in the very production, in the 2017, if we can include that,
mm-hmm,
even in the production,
right,
I think that would be a win-win situation.
Mm-hmm. So I think that, you know, because that brings up, it echoes the controversy or the parallels in Mikado in terms of when the Seattle production was boycotted and was actually shut down. When New York tried to put it up, the New York Gilbert and Sullivan Society were proposing to do Mikado, and they put actors in yellowface on their materials, and it caused a lot of reaction.
Yeah.
And they actually decided to pull the piece. And one of the things that was very interesting in the piece that just, because it actually just premiered in January, the reproduction of that, and or the representation. What Gilbert and Sullivan Society actually chose to do was have to bring in other consultants, to bring in other artists in order to see where and how that perception or the work could actually land. Because it is a canon for Gilbert and Sullivan. How do you actually make that and make it resonant in the 21st century? So I think that one of the things that we'll get to, or hopefully we'll get to throughout the day, is that is how are these conversations actually translating into actual to actions and in progress, and what are things in which that it's not just about a great conversation. Like, I love great.
You know, one of the things we want to do at Houston Grand Opera is form an advisory panel of colleagues like this and people who want to participate and look out into our future repertoire for potential cultural sensitivities that we may not be able to exactly describe, that we may not be able to predict and talk about them as much in advance. That's something that's one of the action items we're taking.
That's great. That's amazing. And I kind of wanted to follow up on that point from you, Patrick, and as well as what you mentioned, Svita, about context. I was talking to some colleagues a few weeks before about, if you're in a position of power, of decision making, of a production company, right? What are some things that you would like to see if you're gonna have a play, a production that's not about your culture or your group of peoples? And the two things that I kind of came out were consent and then respect. So number one of consent is, did you reach out to the community that you're going to base your production on and talk with them about it? Mm-hmm. And are they okay with it? Are there certain things that they're not okay with it? Which is why I love the advisory board that you're talking about, who hopefully those individuals live through and understand the culture.
Yeah.
And then number two, the respect portion is, have you done your due diligence? Have you done your research to understand that culture to the fullest? Making sure that, yes, there are negative aspects in history that have occurred, but are you doing it in an appropriate manner that when this message is received by the audience, what effect does that have? Because I questioned a lot of other film festival directors as you screen a film, but is that it? Like, do you end it there? Or do you have conversations beyond that?
Mm-hmm.
To me, I think the art groups and art organizations, they can take an extra step into understanding what their community is all about and what they feel, which is what we're doing today. I'm very glad for that. I point to one film that we're gonna screen this summer, Mele Murals. It's about these two graffiti artists in Hawaii. They mostly do it for the pureness for art, but they're trying to reach out to a school about historical context. They're trying to paint this mural of traditional Hawaiian culture. They do it first, but they kind of mess up because they haven't consulted with the elders. And the elders came to the school and said, you are doing this completely wrong. And they were like, okay, I understand now. And through going through the traditions, the rituals, and some teachings, basically, in a lot of time, they really grasped the concept. They put their feet in those people's shoes and understood the context. And at the film's end, they get the painting right, basically, and everyone's happy. So I think that's a good example of what we can be doing, too, in Houston and across the country, too.
I agree. I like, going back to the production I did of Death of Klinghoffer, I felt so confident in the piece because my first day of rehearsal, I sat down with the director and the entire cast, both the extras and chorus and everybody, in which there are a lot of Jewish people involved in the cast and the production. And the director was there, and he brought in someone from the Situation Room who would have been there during, I think it was the Reagan era. He would have been there during the Reagan era when this happened, who knew about all the intricacies of this and where the three terrorists had come from and their backgrounds, everything like that. And he sat. The director had brought this guy. I don't know how he found him, but brought him in, and to have this guy there, who was a part of this, the Situation Room at that time with the Reagan administration. And have some other people who are involved with not only knowledge of the characters, but just of jihadism in general and the conflicts that were happening around the world in Eastern, and outside of Israel and around that area. And we sat there for hours asking him every single kind of question we could ask, both some really personal ones, to just what's the mindset of these characters. And this happened in a small room, so all of the people in the cast felt so confident about what we're doing and what direction we wanted to have this. But what they didn't do is have that same sort of conversation with the community like you guys are having now. So maybe that was a PR thing, I'm not sure, but they could have easily solved the problem if they would have brought the same group of people that they brought for us, the artists, to out to the public, to the Jewish community, the Yazidic community in New York. They could have been squashed, because then they would have realized, okay, this 3.5 minute aria that this person's singing is not the entirety of the opera. And just like you have an opera, you have characters, for instance, in Trovatore, you have the Duke, or sorry, the Count, who basically commits, commits rape. He rapes a woman,
yeah.
Right there in front of you. And like that, I mean, if that's not an atrocious act, I don't know what is. But just as much as that is an atrocious act, we are okay with it because it's opera, and like it's not, you know,
it's
an old opera. So, you know, or you know,
I'm not saying
that
we're all okay with it.
We're okay with the act of the knowing that this isn't, this is not reality. This is a story. It's just like we watch movies where bad things happen to people. We know that the bad thing's going to happen. Like from watching 12 Years a Slave, I know that this is a slave movie, that someone is going to go through some really horrible things in this slave movie, like in the title. So in a sense of opera fans, when they go see Il Trovatore, they know that like there's a woman in this opera who's going to have something incredibly horrible happen to her, and they're not going to go see it because the incredible horrible thing is going to happen. It's part of the story that has an ending.
In 2017, I'm going to push back a little bit to say that I think where we're at is actually considering the audience who's not going to go. Like, there are a countless numbers of movies and directors and actors that I will not engage with because of things that they've said,
or
things that they've did. You know, whether it's issues around race, whether it's issues around sexual assault, like, I have cut that stuff out of my life and I feel much healthier for it. And so I think, you know, we're living in a time where, you know, I'm not going to get into this deep dive in the internet, but that 3.5 minutes that's controversial is what people are going to see, and is what new audiences are going to see, and it's what people are going to share. And if that's the only representation that you're getting out into the world, what does that mean?
I know, but what that's why it's so important for them to actually have the conversation and let people know what is the rest of the piece.
Right.
And they didn't do that, which is their mistake.
But I think you also have to consider that there are going to be people, you know, that are so distanced from even being invited into that conversation or clicking past a controversial video. I mean, we're in a time, this is a very different topic, but we're in a time where people are not reading past the headlines. And so what does it mean? How does that change how we write, how we talk about things? You know, I think I can think of plenty of examples of, you know, movies, TV, maybe forms of art that are a little bit more, that are broader than opera, which, you know, I am not an expert on.
Mm-hmm.
But there are moments that define shows. There are moments that define movies that are 60 seconds or 30 seconds or one line. Like, I didn't see 12 Years a Slave because I have issues with Michael Fassbender. Not because, you know, and there are, you know, he's not a great dude. Sorry, if you're
watching.
But anyway, but yeah, but I think, you know, but there are moments, you know, so you can take a controversial movie and have reasons for not, or, you know, a controversial piece of art and have reasons for not engaging with it. And so how, you know, I'm thinking of this as a producer, how am I connecting to an audience that I may never speak to, that I may never get the opportunity to speak to?
And I think that it's, here's the crux, is the conscientious programming.
Yeah.
And in what ways that those who are programming or those who are creating work, how are you making those choices? And how, like, I think if you've been very clear on how some of that actually is informing your programming. But I guess it's a really interesting question. It's like, when do you do a classic? And why do you do a classic? And why do you, like, if only one singer in the entire world can do that, why are you doing it?
Well, let me ask you, I'm going to go back to you, and you mentioned Jeremy Lin. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm a huge sports fan, and Jeremy Lin was amazing for New York. I was living in New York at the time, and it was such an awesome moment in sports, New York sports, to have that happen. But, you know, if you think about basketball, like, who plays basketball? The 90% of the people who play basketball in America, in the highest level, like, you, you, the, to have the physical, the minimum physical requirements to be a star NBA player right. are pretty high. Like, but I could never play it, and so like, what can I do as an African American and to help you like feel better about like not being able to play basketball at the NBA? Like, I can't do it. I mean, like, as far as having more people to be your hero, like, or to feel like you're right. I can't do anything because it's no. I'm built this way. The Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is built 7'2". You know, you can't help that.
Sure, there are physical traits that are just genetic and that occur like that. And I fully understand that. To me, the Jeremy Lin aspect is more so that it's a message to the people that, yeah, you mentioned, not reaching your immediate circles. Those kids who are watching him play is motivating them to pursue it more as a career path. That, to me, is extremely valuable.
I agree.
And to me, that shows, once you have someone up there who's on the biggest stage, who is a different face, it shows that hopefully, you know, as Asian Americans, we are a part of the American story. We are a part of the fabric of this country. We're not this contextual, perpetual foreigner where previous films and plays have, you know, put us in. So having him there and other, you know, and for in the film industry, having leads who are, you know, heroic and who do good things, that has a profound effect on the kids. And I want them to not say, this is not a good career path. I want them to go into the arts. I want them to pursue it as something that could lead to, you know, something special beyond just them, but for the community as a whole. So that to me is what I see as Jeremy Lin. It's not about, you know, he doesn't have the specific, for Asian Americans, not having the specific talents. Like, there will be some that will get in, and there's more coming in every single year.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it behooves us as an art company to be sure that the opportunities are equal.
Right.
That we have to constantly be vigilant about.
Right, and it's not just people on stage. It's also, to me, the people backstage, the producers, the directors, the screenwriters. These are the ones who are the decision makers. Exactly.
Right, because I think a lot of the, you know, the cliches around Southeast Asians that we do absorb are because the people who are in writers' rooms and the people who are producing are not Asian, you know. And I think this is taking a little bit further, but I think something that I wanted to bring up tonight is also, and this is, you know, will be part of the where this is going, but I think it's really important to not just consider Asian perspectives on Asian representation, but considering Asian representations in a broader cultural context. Like, I'm really happy and honored to be part of this conversation, but I've been reading a lot of Audre Lorde lately, and she wrote an essay about 30 years ago about her being invited to a panel at NYU, and she was specifically asked because of her Black queer feminist perspective, but that was also the only panel in the entire programming that asked for that perspective. She's like, why isn't my Black queer feminist perspective important in a conversation about film more generally? You know, so I think that we have to push beyond, you know, we're making strides, but I think we have to push beyond even just having Asians represent Asians, but Asians represent America.
In the fact that I'm here now, I'm definitely not white, nor am I Asian. And for the fact that I'm here is for me a huge honor, like, and something I would never expected for someone like myself to be a part of. But even now, just being a part of this has educated me a little more on being more understanding of another aspect of this country. And you know, I've only seen the aspect of the country through my lens my entire life. And just now, as becoming more of a man. And at 30 years old, I'm starting to think of things, you know, about the future of maybe my children in the future and what things they should be thinking about, how I should be teaching them to look at everyone around them, not just a black and white lens, but maybe a black, white, Asian, Native American, there's so many lenses they can look from. And I think it's so important to have these conversations at a young age so people can realize or start thinking about, so they have bigger thoughts in the future about what the world is, who we are as people.
I want to go back to my conversation is how amazing it is to, in the United States, you could have this conversation. For example, my daughter's elementary school, she went to evolved elementary school, and in there are 45 countries represented. When I was when I first enrolled her in that school, and they said they have an international week, and I was like, oh, you know, I'm international. I know what's international. So I went to the international week there. I was so humbled because they're Asian. It's, they don't talk about international in terms of Asian. They have Japan, Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Southeast Asia. You know, it's so, the 45 countries being represented in that school. And all my my daughter's friends, they speak at least two languages. Mm-hmm. One, English, and when they go home, they have a second language, French, Latino, and then Chinese, Vietnamese, and all that. And when they go there, they speak a certain language. And this is kind of situation you see in America. Mm-hmm. You do not see that in Asia. I cannot stress enough on that beauty of this this diversity, this vitalness of, you know, and then your formal identity. I think America formal identity is neither Asia or West, Asian or West. It's a new kind of identity of a new 21st century that is all of us. If we want to be look forward to this 21st century that we are now, this is what we need to embrace. That's the reality. Not just only talk about stressing only Asia, only West, only something, but we need to think this is the whole new world.
I think that we also need to, like, thank you for bringing up the multiplicity of Asianness, like the multiple cultures, multiple histories, multiple conflicting histories and all this. But I also want to bring up this idea about generational, because first generation, second generation, third generation in Asian cultures are, like, I've lived and seen that a lot. So I guess if anybody wants to talk a little bit more about what has been some of the generational disconnect or some of the general, the conversations or problems we've even had among generations.
Yeah. I can start. this is a very big topic for me. I just want to say, for those who have immigrated to this country first, number one, thank you for taking that risk, for being courageous in getting here. You came for a better life. You came for your, hopefully for your children to have a better life. And then when I talk with some of the elders, that conversation of coming for a better life is security. How can we make sure that the next generation, financially and status-wise, they're secure and there's no risks that they face back in their country? But to me, I also see it as you came here for the freedom of choice. You came for the opportunities that America presents. And with that freedom of choice comes exploration of different avenues and paths to express yourself, self-expression. Whether it is STEM, whether it is the arts, whether it is sports, that should be something that the children, I believe, can have more input in, I hope. But unfortunately, a lot of the older generation, they want to say, you've got to go down a safer path because we don't want you to live what we've lived through. Mm. And I fully understand that. And I want, this is kind of my closing point, but I want those two different generations to have more dialogue about that. Because I know from the younger side, we talk amongst ourselves about that, and I know among the older side, they talk amongst themselves about that. But there needs to be more where they talk to each other instead of about each other, because you're not gonna get really anywhere with that. And honestly, I learned a lot, talking to my own parents about these things and other of my peers with their parents about this. So start with conversation, just like what we're doing here is having conversations.
Stephen, when we met with OCA at HDO, and you were a part of, we were both a part of that in mid-February, I don't know if it was you, but others on that panel, and that was a very, very, very positive meeting that I think that we had with the Organization of Chinese Americans, the Houston chapter here. But there was very much a feeling that the younger generation of Asian Americans were not going into the arts. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't think that's the case in Asia, in terms of classical music.
Yes and no.
But that was very much a takeaway.
You should learn, you should do art, you should learn piano, join. But to make it as a living,
okay.
it's
okay.
another
was very much a takeaway. That was a takeaway from that meeting.
Just one small correction. OCA is all Pan-Asian. We're no longer just Organization of Chinese American. So I just want to make a quick correction. But to your point, yes. I guess if you want to look at statistically, there are a lot of parents who, if they want their children to pick up the arts, it's for extracurricular.
Okay.
It's for getting into, you know, getting more merit for going into college. But it's not a...
When did this start? I don't know how much older I am than you, but I can tell you from my college experience, like from undergrad, even grad school, I would say we had this thing called 2020 in my undergrad for like the 20 best musicians in my school, and I would say 15 of them were Asian. And they're from all over, not just American, they're from Japan, Korea, China, all right. over. And I've noticed even from when I started music, which is very late in my life, like the musicians that tend to be win all the competitions when I was younger were of Asian descent. Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering when does this happen where this is becoming less relevant now as a job? Because in college you go to college, I assume, to pursue it as a career.
Yeah,
it's been a long time.
But it stopped recently?
Always the case, but don't forget there's a lot of Asian.
Oh no, this is very, very true.
I'm kind of curious of those 15 that you mentioned. How many were Asian American?
Not many.
Yeah.
Like, but there were. Let's put it this way: there were no African Americans, obviously, in it. And the ones that were non-Asian were Caucasian.
I think not to say that they're different. They're very unique experiences being Asian versus being Asian American. Growing up Asian in your motherland country, you are the majority. You are the voice of the people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Versus if you're Asian American in the United States, you are by far the smallest group. Growing at the fastest rate, but still the smallest group. Yeah. So that's a different perspective when you grow up in this country. Just looking around, right, in your surroundings. I grew up in the South. In my elementary school, I was only one of like maybe two or three Asian Americans in the whole school. I didn't see a lot of Asian American faces until high school and then college and when I came here to Houston. But when you grow up in that environment, the way you carry yourself changes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Versus if you were the majority where everyone around you looks similar, you're more, I guess, quote unquote, comfortable mm-hmm. with the surroundings. So I think that plays a factor with the decision making of do I want to send my kid to the arts? Because I see that as quote unquote risky, and then I don't want my children to suffer through what I may have suffered in the past.
Yeah.
And for you, information, because I'm from the world.
Yes.
It's the same.
Right.
The Asians still do not see that as a good. Because Asia, financially, it's you know, the war and everything, it's difficult. So they still want the kids to do that to you.
Yeah. Well, it may be more universal than we think. My parents
yeah.
didn't want me to be a musician.
Yeah, but I think that the perspective that you were talking about, Stephen, between Asian and Asian American is interesting even within a household. Because
yeah.
it's only until relatively recently that I started having conversations with my own parents about like how outsider I felt growing up. Because they didn't necessarily recognize that perspective because they had grown up in India, surrounded by Indians, and then moved, and their focus was more on, you know, career and family, and didn't really consider what our perspective was going to school, because they paralleled it to their perspective going to school. You know, I was also one of like, very few Indian kids in my school. So I think there was a disconnect within households. You know, everyone's talking about their age, 33. And I had that conversation really with my parents, very honestly, about 3 weeks ago. You know, and I think, you know, there is something that's really eye-opening about, for me, I've lived in Houston for about 3 years, and it's exciting to have this conversation here, because I think even for me at this age, a lot of the perspective and on who I am, which then leads to the art that I want to bring to the city, came from moving to Houston and actually seeing more diverse faces in audiences like this or gallery openings. And we're certainly not perfect, but I think it's more, you know, it is more diverse. We're the most diverse city in the country. But it's, you know, I think pretty late in recognizing my own, like the power of my own ethnicity, rather than, you know, there was something, I think, especially being younger, where, like I was talking about artists on stage, you know, sort of being defined by being juxtaposed with whiteness, like I went through that as a kid too, and I think I came to a new perspective in living in a really diverse city. So I think it's important to be able to share that perspective with people who don't have the opportunity to necessarily like program or see art. Like I'm really interested in getting folks to the work that we present who wouldn't necessarily see art because they might be using art as a tool to understand their own identity when they wouldn't have considered it because they don't know that they're going to be represented.
So great. Great segue. And I mean, because if we are talking about audiences, if we're talking about new audiences, and if we're talking about, I'm like, is the assumption that audiences want to go see something that they that is familiar to them on stage?
This is where it's going to get controversial.
There is not one opera audience. There are several. Mm-hmm. And the current largest opera audience wants to see a mixture of things that are familiar with mixed with things that are more challenging. But the largest group of those people are very drawn to what they know. But there are other audiences that absolutely have no interest in seeing another production of La Bohème and want to see our new pieces that are off-site. And you know, so there are audiences are segmented largely, which is very challenging if you are an arts company our size and structured as we are as a subscription-based, seasonal opera company, because that's not necessarily what the culture is doing now, but that's how we are structured. So you know, we have to cast a very wide net of activity to embrace all of those audiences, because there isn't just one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think, you know, we're I'm sort of in the opposite position of not relying on subscriptions. We're very fortunate to be a free festival, so we're able to invite audiences into the room, and I think the work then becomes really making sure that if we're trying to use art to represent different people, different experiences, how do we make sure that the people we're trying to represent are actually connecting? Again, it goes back to the question of like the value of art in relation to culture and generation, and I think that is a challenge.
Well, I guess part of it, I think to me it also loops back to these questions about changing standards, and like with new audiences, the standards of what is accepted or what is good changes.
Is this one I get to bring up? I had one, my main goal for tonight was to bring up Short Circuit 2, which, as some of you may know, featured
Fisher Stevens,
thank you, in brownface, playing an Indian scientist with a very heavy Indian accent. I found out that was not an Indian man in the year 2015. You're learning a lot about like my early 30s discoveries about myself. Sorry. But, you know, I brought that up with my parents, and we started talking about the television show Master of None, which was produced by Aziz Ansari and starred Aziz Ansari. And I started talking to them about, you know, their perspective coming to the country. They came in the late 70s, and what they thought about these kind of overwrought, cliched representations of Indians. And, you know, at that point, it was largely in movies. And at some point, it felt really good. It felt really good to be represented at all. It felt really good to be like, oh, they're even considering that, like, Indians live in this country or work in these jobs or exist in this universe. And as standards have changed, as we've continued to have conversations like this, as we've sort of demanded, I think, more of each other, and as this country gets more diverse, that has had to evolve. You know, I'm no one's happy seeing a complete cliche of themselves represented on screen. And I think that's been a really interesting shift. You know, it goes back to the complexity of, like, yes, you may be Indian, but can you also be this? Yes, you may be Indian, but why do you have to have an accent in every role that you play?
Any other comments on that part?
I have just one quick one. That aspect of having a specific role for a specific group of people, at least for Asian Americans, I've seen fall into the model minority myth, which a lot of people may know about. And that has ramifications not only for the Asian American community, but also I think it affects other communities as well, saying that, okay, we put Asian Americans on the pedestal, what does it say about everyone else, right? Mm-hmm. And not only limits our own group of people, but it kind of defines other groups of people at the same time. So it's almost like a double bad sword, in a way.
Oh, yeah, and the fact that Asian Americans have been weaponized against other brown people, yep, in order to say that, well, why couldn't you be as good as the Asians?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And horrible and wrong-headed in so many other ways. But I think, Patrick, did you have a comment on that? Or?
Well, I think this is related, because in opera being a live performing art, and a, you know, you come to an opera performance and 2,400 people experience it together, and then it's gone. You know, it's not filmed, it's not a document, it's a very different medium from film. And so we're not only casting roles, we're casting opera singers' careers, you know, and singers who with whom we engage both in the studio or like, you know, Ryan, I'm hoping to have, you know, 20 years of things from you know, Ryan.
That's on tape.
And dreaming that out into the future with a very small set of gifted singers is one of the great joys and challenges of this art form. But that is slightly different from, you know, if I were making a film of Madama Butterfly, you know, that's going to exist forever and is not going to be seen by 2,000 people at one time, but it's going to be seen by millions of people for years, then your casting demands are very different, you know, and your casting intentions are very different. But if I have a gifted soprano who needs at some point in her own creative life to take on Madama Butterfly, mm-hmm, for her own artistic reasons, and we can make that work with integrity, then I also have the responsibility of her career, mm-hmm, not just the responsibility to Puccini and Madama Butterfly. Mm-hmm. And that's just one repertory opera. There are many.
You know, how do we bring that back to the idea of opportunity?
Exactly.
Like, how, you know, if we're having this conversation now, and you know, obviously there is limited talent, especially in a form like opera or basketball, but how are we doing the work at a younger age to foster,
exactly,
you know, more diverse communities into pursuing those talents? Because, mm-hmm, I think that that's still not really happening.
I agree.
You know, it's not that there's not enough. You know, there are
the
I understand that.
There.
Yeah, exactly, and it's not being fostered. It's not being accepted.
Speedo, you had a.
Well, I mean, I'm coming on actually both those things, like you know, the preconceptions I talked about earlier about you know, the different ethnicities in America, and when it comes to you know, R&B or you know, how many Asian R&B singers you know that are singing on the Super Bowl, you know, like, but it's the same thing as far as, like, you know, African Americans. I can speak from my lens. You know, there may be small preconceptions, as small as they may be, they still affect casting. Like, you know, when I go into an audition for an opera, or just a general audition for casting, it could be with any company, you know, at a young age, or, you know, coming from college, in between the college and mainstream where I'm now, and I walk into an audition room and there's a panel of people involved, judges or administration, and they walk in, and you know, it could be a small preconception of like, man, I hope this person doesn't have a gospel sounding voice, or you know, I hope that they actually can sing in a foreign language, and they or you know, sort of things that people think in the back of their minds when they just see a color of someone's skin. And you know, those preconceptions can happen to, you know, Asian artists as well. You know, when they're going out to audition for a musical, you know, I don't know, not Rent or West Side Story or something like that, and they're thinking when this person walks in, well, what preconception could they have about Asian artists? So we, you know, hearing you guys talk about it, kind of, you know, again, I've thought about my own preconception that people might think about me when I walk into a room, any kind of room. You know, I'm 6'4", 300 pounds, like, and I people immediately think what they want to think, and maybe they think differently if my skin was white instead of black. And then you talked about the programs that allow the cultivation of young talent to maybe become that Asian Madame Butterfly in the future. I grew up in a trailer park. I didn't have I didn't grow up in a big city. I grew up in the country in a trailer park, and it was by chance that I happened to go on a field trip to go to New York, and they were seeing musicals, and I happened to see an opera. And that one day at one special weekend when I was 15, I saw an opera with it that just happened to have an African American as the lead, which rarely happened at that point in American history. and to be there at that one moment and see a person who looked like me, as you said, on stage performing as a main character in an art form that I never knew a person like me could ever do, made me think. When I left there, okay, I know what I want to do with my life. I want to be an opera singer. Mm-hmm. And here I am now.
It was that exposure.
An opera singer.
It was that exposure that really resonated.
And especially from where my circumstance, I didn't come from a well-to-do family or a musical or have the opportunities to be in to have a piano, grand piano or violin lessons at 5. No, I just happened to be in a school field trip. And it made me want to pursue it on my own. My parents didn't have anything to do with it. It was purely my desire to want to become a part of this art form. Mm-hmm.
And I think I also want to recognize the incredible journey and the uniqueness of this, because part of what we're talking about is a privilege in order to be able to have those classes, to have those lessons, to have the master teachers, for the parents to be able to work in order to be able to afford those lessons. And like there are structural aspects here that are problematic for certain communities of color or disadvantaged aspects. And what are we thinking, how are we thinking about, and how are we actually making sure that that is? Because even if you're a talented Asian, we'll push you over to the piano or the violin.
Right.
We're not gonna push you to sing. And like, you know, that there are conceptions in terms of what that is. I know that's really stereotypical and horrible for me
but
to say. But you know, anyway.
But it's still happening. And I think, you know, as someone who's not, not normally on stage, those cliches of stereotypes happen when you're an arts administrator or a cultural producer too. I've walked into rooms where people don't know me. I've walked into rooms where people do know me, and they assume just by looking at me that my experience is like, I know Indian dance really well. I don't know Indian dance very well. I know a lot of other dance really well. I'm at a meeting, and it's these slight things, these slight moments where it's like, oh yeah, there's an Indian dancer, and someone will gesture towards me. I'm like, gesture over there. Like, we're all at the same table. I don't think that has any, you know, devious undertone in it, but that's still the way that we function.
Yeah. I want to bring back the what Patrick was talking about. He had to cast a really big net of the different kind of audience.
Yeah.
There's some audience see music or arts as entertainment, mm-hmm. and there's some people mm-hmm. see music or arts as a way to ask questions or to learn something from this, and so me as an audience, when I see a movie or an art or even an opera, I ask questions and what do I learn from this? If you don't teach me something new, I feel this is not
worthwhile.
Not worthwhile mm-hmm. for me, and so we have to see. also the using the opportunity to educate our audience, because I'm also a teacher, and so I you know, you want to see, of course there's a majority of people who want to see that as entertainment, but then, and yet happened to be, that person happened to be there, you know, and that's a good education situation and possibility. This might flower, this little seed might flower to an amazing flower or tree in the future, and we never know. And so if we see that music or art is any production as a chance to educate and to have a possibility to allow a seed to become flowers in the future, then we will see it very differently.
Yeah.
I have a question. Like, you know, you said you're originally from where?
Taiwan.
Taiwan. Like, in grad school, I participated in grad school productions, and the lady who did the costuming, she was a volunteer. Her name was Lucy Ho, and she was an entrepreneur, like actually a very important entrepreneur in Tallahassee, Florida, and she opened up a slew of restaurants and other. She came to America, I'm not sure with what she came with to America from Taiwan, but she created an empire for herself and her family. And and she volunteered her time to just do costumes for the opera, because she loved opera. I happened to just sneak there one day for a fitting, and she happened to have the entire, like her entire costume department was full of Asian students. And I was like, what is this? And so apparently, like, there was some underwritten thing where all of the Asian students would come to her, foreign students and Asian American students would come to her office during lunch hours, and she would cater for all of the Asian students from no matter where you were from. And I thought this was so cool. And so she's like, oh, if you want to come eat, then you have to, like, sing for us. So I started coming to this sort of like Lucy Ho's hangout spot in the lunch hour, and meeting all these interesting people from all over. She actually brought a lot of her home, the Taiwanese New Year. She had a festival that she like started there, like with which got bigger and bigger and bigger with the Asian community, and both Chinese and Taiwanese people for the New Year. And I was honored to, I sang like some piece with, it took me like months to learn, it was only like a minute long, I sing this with a couple of instrumentalists and for the Taiwanese New Year, and it was so cool for me to be able to just absorb so much of their culture and just the stories and the food, and that was a way to bring sort of me as an outsider into their community and appreciate her community, but what she brought to Florida State. Yeah. And I think that was so beautiful, and moments like that can easily happen. Nice. when as much as you want people to understand what bothers you and what's not right in the world, I think it's really good to open your doors and your community to outsiders, so we can really understand what is Asian culture, what is Taiwanese culture, what is Chinese culture, what is Indian culture, so we can start to understand, maybe not immediately, but maybe my children who are there will pique an interest, so when that moment comes where they're in a position of power or position to invite more experiences or more, ideas and have that sort of panel like we're doing now, they're already having in their mind, like, okay, I need to invite this person, this person, and it will be just a question of if, it's a matter of I should. And I think that's something that would help us as a person who doesn't understand, who's not a person who grew up in your culture, to be a part of your culture. And it's not something that's given to me by TV, at least not accurately, what I'm hearing from you guys. And I would really love to, for I think that'll be great. There are people like me who are very interested in knowing about it. In a way that isn't maybe necessarily panel discussion about things you shouldn't do and da 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 da, but maybe let me invite you to have a dish, like have a real authentic Indian dish or a real authentic Taiwanese dish.
Yes,
and then
always.
Next thing you know, tell me all your stories, and then that's a way to really in a positive way breed a conversation without pointing fingers.
Well, I think that it also brings up the whole aspect of generosity, and really, if we're entering into the space with generous intentions, then
I think that the what we will get out of that space is a lot different, you know, instead of if we're coming into it hypercritically. And I think that, but I also have to say, at a certain point, when will it always be my responsibility in order to educate you?
This is very true. I've been saying this for a very long time for other things.
I'm like, I think that we do that, and as an educator, that's part of what it is. But at a certain point, I'm tired. Mm-hmm. I'm tired of going to the same conversation and having the same conversation about where I come and what my name means.
Mm-hmm. I am totally with you. Before I came here today, I feel that way. But I'm so happy to be here today because it's ongoing job. I mean, you don't have a choice, right? If you want this to be, you want people to feel, you want the people to feel sensitive, you need to make an effort to do that on an everyday basis.
Yeah.
Sometimes you're allowed to be resting fine, but there are most of days, if you want to be misrepresented and misunderstood, mm-hmm. it is an effort to do it.
I mean, we have to believe, as a musician, I believe that the art of music and the making of music, it teaches empathy because you have to be empathic to be a musician, because nobody can be a musician alone. And so I think we have to continue to believe that in whatever our respective art forms, whatever they may be, that there is empathy to be found embedded in that art form. And the more we can approach our decisions from an empathic and really global perspective, I think the better we will be and the better art we will make. Mm-hmm. They're lofty words, but there are very concrete ways to do that every day. Yes. You know,
to me, we had this conversation earlier about respectful criticism. To me, this is the part where, it's a part of the job. If you're gonna be in the arts, you're going to get criticism, good or bad, respected or not respected.
Oh yeah.
And it comes with the territory. It's just, the next step is how do you address it? Do you ignore it? Do you embrace it? Do you deal with it? Do you just want to, put it underneath the rug? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of ways of handling that criticism. So I think what you mentioned about empathy, if you are in that empathetic mode, it would behoove you to really embrace the respectful criticism.
Yeah.
When OCA Greater Houston contacted HGO, we had that meeting.
Yes.
We had a positive discussion about both sides of the story. And I think a lot of great actions were coming out of that. Mm-hmm. We talked about the youth engagement, exposing the ones that may not have the resources to go to HGO and see theater and the beauty that it is. We're trying to work with HGO Co. with bringing opera to go into the Asian American community, opera camps for maybe some scholarship opportunities where families who are more economically disadvantaged can participate in this. And really encourage and show them that this is a good thing to do, and to explore at least, at the minimum.
And I think taking that criticism as, accepting it as being as valuable as 100 pieces of praise. Yeah. I think it's about the praise you'll always get. Someone's always gonna like what you're doing, especially if you have a following. But I think the criticism needs to be, like you're saying, accepted and absorbed and processed. I think it's easy to dismiss one person who's offended by something mm-hmm. when you have 500 people. You were talking about this a little bit. The show in New York, when you have 500 people who are really praising it, but if we're gonna talk about empathy, mm-hmm. then talk to the one person that felt offended and accept that they were offended or misrepresented or felt that, because you can't devalidate that. You can't devalidate someone feeling like that.
But could you also say you can't please everybody?
I think you can, sure. You can't please everybody. And maybe that you're going to make another piece of art, another work that would continue to offend a new person or the same person. But at least you've had the conversation, mm-hmm. and at least you've considered it important, I think.
You valued it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You're not dismissing it as something that you didn't have to, that wasn't sort of an actionable conversation.
So you didn't offend the person out of ignorance or not because you didn't mean to do that, just because you didn't know, you don't know.
Okay, so because we are talking about performing arts and audience is so important, and because we've just been talking about generosity and positive criticism and respectful discourse, we're going to open it up to y'all and ask questions. There are microphones that are here, they're up in the front, and we ask you to go to the microphones because it is being live streamed in order to do this. So in order so that everybody can hear as well. Remind you, like, also once again, generosity, kindness, and empathy. Let's put those out there again and again. Yes, your name?
Good evening, I'm Joy Scott.
Hi, Joyce.
And as a rule, I don't use a mic because I don't want to shake the walls. Young man, I'm so proud of you. All of you, I'm so proud of you. I live the life of the women in Hidden Figures. That's very unusual because you guys wouldn't know that I was a computer programmer who kicked white boys' asses.
Yes. So what I heard is like we echo this back to this aspect of conversations and making sure that we're having the conversations not only in the artistic aspect, but also are we making sure that we're having conversations with our audiences and hey, actually be receptive to some like whatever the audience might say sometimes. Put that out there. Yes.
Yes.
I think that, I mean, part of the way Wan Chan is actually here, and thank you very much for being here. So, I think that this has been part of the conversation as to if we actually, like, how we believe when representation is important, and when representation is sometimes, and what are the ramifications and when representation actually doesn't happen. And I think, and part of the reason why I'm intercepting this question is that this is not just about Nixon and China. This is not just about Wei Wan's Chan impression about this. It is about what I live every day. This is about what some of us live every day and how these aspects of representation are important and resonant. And if it is this important to us, I imagine it's also important to an awful lot of audience members, considering this is a gorgeous Friday evening and y'all are here. So, and it's Friday evening, so there are at least 30 other arts events that are happening. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to be just specifically about that one piece, but I think that we've covered much of that ground tonight.
Mm-hmm. So do you want me to answer the question? We set out to cast primarily vocally first, And I don't begin a conversation about a character with, you know, what ethnicity is this singer? I start with, can they deliver this score? And can they, and I would no more say to Ryan that he can't play King Philip in Don Carlo because he doesn't look Spanish, than I would say to an Asian singer who was very gifted, I'm sorry, you can't play Carmen because you're Asian. I mean, I wouldn't say
or
that.
Or Otello,
yeah. So I think we always can be better at being more inclusive and opening the playing field to make the opportunities equal. I think we can always be better at that, all of us. But I think we had a cast I was extremely proud of in Nixon in China, and continue to be so.
Thank
to
you.
To answer your question.
Hi, I'm Wei Chen. I'm the arts critic for the Houston Chronicle, and I wrote the review, I guess, that started it all. So I really appreciate.
I actually want to push back. It actually just catalyzed part of this conversation. This conversation, many of the people in this room have been having this conversation for years. And yeah. Some of us, unfortunately, have been having it even before you were born. So I'm not. Thank you for catalyzing this conversation, but I also want to put this into a larger context that this is,
I guess the background for me is that when I saw Nixon in China, I had a couple of questions, I guess. My first question was, like, my job is to go out and see as many performances in Houston as possible. My question was, why is this the first and only time Chinese culture has ever been represented in the span of like 7 months? And it's, again, what I described in the review, a bunch of white people in Fu Manchus, and that's really what I saw. They were doing Kung Fu, they were doing Tai Chi, they were in conical rice hats. That was not the type of Asian America that I saw represented. And my other question, which has to do with like the other Asians, is like, why does no one care? Why wasn't anyone, like, why does it take one younger, angry person to get a bunch of people sitting together and being all happy and kind of nodding together? I'm just curious, like, why does it take so much to get this needle moving? Why does it take so much and for one person to risk so much to, you know, get this going? I'm curious. Just, I appreciate the broadness of this panel, but how do the panels feel about Nixon in China? How do you feel about Yellowface? Is it right? Is it wrong? Patrick essentially made a justification for why Yellowface is okay. Do the panels agree with that?
I don't think that we, I don't, well, one, I'm not sure that we actually justified Yellowface. I'm not sure that anybody, I think that we actually have said that representation is powerful and potent and can be harmful. And I think that as much as, yeah. Somebody else should respond.
I want to address the second question. It's a very good question of like what you said about you catalyze this discussion. And going back to Sixto's point, this conversation has been going on forever amongst the Asian American community. Even here in Houston, we had a representation tea talk, which is a community roundtable discussion on Asian American representation in media last summer in our film festival. And it's about how do you know about these events? That's the thing, right? Are events reaching out to you specifically? And what I see for a lot of the Asian American community is we're segmented. I mean, that's a fact, right? You read the news that pleases you, or only things that you see. But do you get uncomfortable enough to reach out to your group of people, to people that you may disagree with? Like, have you reached out to the Asian American community with OCA, and there's so many different organizations that do great work in the city for these specific issues? Why? And I know you reached out to Cecil Fong, our president, on the issue, but if you come to our events, we are talking about these things. It's not that we're silent and we don't care. I think this shows we care. And we're going to continue to care moving forward.
And just on top of that, I think there are many ways of dealing with the situation, or I mean, you are a critic, therefore you choose this way, and that's very powerful. And there are some people choose to do very, you know, I don't know, grassroots scale, or like this lady in Florida. You know, she's doing a lot of things. You know, I am doing a lot of things. Asia Society is doing a lot of things. We all collectively, we do care. Collectively, we do things just because it's not becoming like a big controversial, and doesn't mean that doesn't that we don't care. Mm-hmm.
I guess one of the other things is that you have a platform, and I'm glad you utilize it. Part of the reason why we have all these people on this panel is that each of us has a different platform.
Yes, exactly.
And how are we utilizing those platforms in order to be able to do this? Yours happens to be really public, and that's what you get paid to do. And part of it, and that's thrilling. But part of it is that how are we each taking this opportunity in order to have those conversations? Yeah. Because this is what my life has been for the past 25 years.
I think there's a difference between, you know, your platform as someone who's defined as a critic is, you know, the sort of, the reception of that is different. What you're being asked is different. But, you know, in a maybe romantic and topical way, like, existing as an Indian American and trying to work in the arts world, for me, every day is an act of activism.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Sure. Yeah.
I'm just curious what you guys think about the Nixon and China controversy. Do you agree with my review? Do you disagree? Do you agree with the
I think issues? That, like, we can actually, like, I can actually talk to you about, like, my personal opinions of Nixon and China on another. I think this forum, I think, has been something where I want to talk about beyond that, and really what we've actually managed, I think, is to be addressing a larger context. And Nixon and China is an art piece which deserves to have discussion. But we are talking, I think, about a larger cultural context. So you and I will talk later, but sir, question.
First of all, I want to thank Houston Grand Opera and the people in Houston over 30 years ago to commission John Adams for this opera. Mm-hmm. 30 years ago, I was not in Houston, but I watched the premiere in Brooklyn when I was in New York. Mm. 30 years ago, I was much younger. I was much radical and much angry. I watched the Brooklyn premiere. I was not offended. I don't remember I was offended. John Adams produced a very powerful opera. There was the first encounter of two universes at that time. I have no problem with the Red Detachment Woman, okay? If you talk about the yellow face stuff, Yuan Chengye was here. I spent hours with Yuan Chengye when he was here. He was the one who performed online in the HGO production of the Nixon in China, including two of his colleagues, classmates in Houston. Yeah. I asked him, okay, because John Adams, first of all, I was the audience, and I have nothing to do with performing art. I'm an engineer. Okay, but coming back to our discussion with Yuan Chengye, okay, even I can appreciate, because I went to the after performance talk with the soprano. Uh-huh. So I've seen John Adams' vocal music is very difficult.
Yeah.
Okay, this is different from some of the light opera we referred to earlier. I think some of those light opera, many artists can perform. So I posed a very difficult question for Yuan Chengye, put him on the spot. I said the two key roles, Mao and his wife Zhang, if we put the performance level at this bar, how many Asian artists can meet that bar? He had a hard time to come up with the answer. Mm-hmm. For Mao's wife, there may be a Korean singer can do it. Mao, he cannot identify a really high qualified person to perform that role. If we use the vocal as a standard, it's there. Okay? But let me, at this point, I turn around and I'm going to criticize HGO production. Mm-hmm. Okay? I have no problem with the Red Detachment Woman. I have no problem to portray the landlord as an evil. But I think the HGO production kind of put him like a crown. And that's not appropriate, I think. Mm-hmm. I think it's appropriate to portray Nixon's wife as an innocent American girl, totally shocked by this first encounter. That's appropriate. There are minor things, for example, as in the red detachment woman, the armbell used to put on red guard. Mm-hmm. The ballet was back in the Chinese Civil War days.
In the 1960s.
Right.
Yeah.
There was no red guard at that time.
Okay.
Okay. Your performance still have the armbell here put on red guard. Mm-hmm. Okay, those are minor things. Yeah. But what offended Mo the most is the third act.
Yeah.
When Kissinger and the Mao's secretary was falling in the back in the shadow. I think American, I think you used to humiliate the politicians, right?
Yeah.
We heard about Kissinger has a tendency to womanize and so forth, okay? But first of all, I don't think that enhances the drama of this opera.
Okay.
Two, you have to keep in mind, in Asian people, we have an image that American soldiers went to Asia, fooling around with a Vietnamese girl, Korean girl, Japanese girl. That brings back very bad memory.
Sure.
The bottom line, that's poor taste. Mm-hmm. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cecilia Pham, and just for full disclosure, I am an immediate OCA Greater Houston past president, and I also used to work at Project Row Houses, so I was very blessed to get to work with Pia when they first started doing Cameron Current Festival through that, and I love the depth and the breadth and the diversity that you bring through Countercurrent and giving it to the Houston community for free. It's amazing, and it broadens people's minds and gives young people an opportunity to go to these events and really learn about the arts and maybe perhaps become artists themselves in the future. One of the things that I want to harken back to Sixto's comment that this is a discussion that's been happening for decades, for generations after generations. And it's great that we have these discussions. It's great we have these panels. And it's great that we are willing to sit here, discuss, and talk about it. But I want to walk away from these discussions with a plan of action, with a call to action. What can we, as movers and shakers in our community, the producers, the funders, the backers, the audience, what can we hold us and our arts community to a higher standard so that we don't have these discussions year in and year out, decade after decade? And it should be a discussion in the future where it's, I cannot believe that we have an Asian Othello. I cannot believe half of the ballet company is African American. I cannot believe that there are leads now that are, you know, of different race and ethnicity in these major companies like the symphony and like the opera. And those are the discussions that I would like to have 20 years from now, in which I had hoped I can see before I die. And so that my kids and my grandkids are not having these discussions. And so my question to you as the
That's
movers and shakers
question.
Is how can you move the needle forward? What are you committing to do, your part?
Like you all, you are always such a forward thinker, because that's actually our closing question to the panelists. And not that I like, and actually I do want to keep it as a closing question, because I want to close us out very much upon that. So we are getting any other questions? No, we can have more. I want to ask some other questions. I want to make time for other questions.
Yes,
yeah, that's going to be a closing question that we will get to in a few minutes. But we want to leave. Part of the intention is that we are leaving this room with very clear action steps from the people who are on this stage, and hopefully that you all are also thinking about what are those action steps and how you are able to ally with and associate with in order to make some of these, to manifest some of those realities that we're talking about.
Hi. My name is Jenny Sito. First off, let me thank you for presenting this panel. It's probably one of the few times I've heard an actual 360 perspective on this issue. I want to follow up on her question about future action, but I also want to follow up on Speedo and Pia and Stephen's comments earlier on about youth engagement. And that is, you know, whitewashing and lack of representation and lack of roles happen not just on the professional stage. They start at the very earliest levels in youth theater companies, in high school productions. And it can be very discouraging for Asian Americans, Black Americans, Latinos, to go, young children to go into those productions and never get cast or get cast in very marginal roles. I'm a mother of two working actors, and fortunately, they persevered through it all, and they are now have a career in the field. But I have seen many instances where kids drop out because they lack the opportunity to continue. And if you don't give the opportunity to them at that early level, then you close off the pipeline that Patrick was talking about. So what is your advice for maybe the youth that are coming up?
I think that's about more representation. We've talked a little bit about more representation, not just on stage, but in people who are teaching, who are administering, who are in schools, who are working with youth, because I think that that's where the discouragement will decrease. Is that if you're talking about an Asian American, a young Asian American working with a teacher in their school who's encouraging their arts career, who's also Asian American, they're going to see the success of that. They're going to have someone to look up to. They're going to have some understanding at a young age that it is possible.
I think for me, I'm going to say this the opposite for me. The person who motivated me the most to be who before I even was an opera singer, motivated me the most to think that I could be something other than a gangster or drug addict or living in the hood was a white woman who was the 5'1" Irish Catholic. And she was a special ed teacher, and at a young age, when I was in special ed, and majority of my class, we had one white kid in the entire class full of African American troublemakers. She told me that I could be something, that I could be someone, that I wasn't just a color. She made every single one of those kids in that class memorize the Martin Luther King "I Have a Dream" speech. So every morning we went to class, we had to say this speech, and it became a mantra for all of us there. And for me, that's something, even though I left that class and I got in trouble later on in my life, it was still part of my life. And it's something I thought about as I did go see my first opera and I saw this person on stage performing an art form that was so far beyond me at the time. I thought, man, one day I could dream to be something like that. And I think, it's up to the educators, as you said before, whether you're white, Black, Asian, you know, it's up to them to motivate all students, not just any color. And if there's someone with potential, or there's someone who really loves to be a part, who wants to be a part of something, and maybe they don't have the exact all of the tools to be great at it at first, maybe it's up to you as an educator to maybe give that person some after-school lessons, or to point that person in a direction where they could get some extra help, so they can be better at whatever they want to be better at, not just say you suck, move on. And I think that at a young age, the kind of encouragement children need and young teenagers need is to know to not give up, because it's maybe normal to give up and to try something else. But if it, like, the best things in life take work and are hard to get and are hard to obtain. Yes. And I learned that at a later in my life, when I wanted to be an opera singer, I didn't have any of the tools to be an opera singer. I didn't know how to read music. I didn't have a voice. I couldn't get on stage without crying. But the people around me and the educators around me didn't give up on me. They're like, if you really want to do this, you're going to have to work hard. And I kept working hard, and it took me pretty much 10 years of my life to even get to a point where people could accept what I was doing was good. And I think that's important to know in any art form, including acting and art. And some people are born with it. Some people, you have to work your butt off to be even acceptable. And if you want to make that sacrifice, you have to be taught at a young age, you have to put everything into it.
So I think that we have time for two quick questions. I guess, I'll speak very personally. One, it is about that, it is coming about a question of inquisitiveness and generosity. I think that it's easy in order to respond to that in that way in positive aspects. If it is about representation or about an obligation, then you're not gonna get the best out of me in this aspect. And I think that if it is about, and it's not just about me, who are the other people you have around that are actually, can you build a broader aspect? It's not just the one Asian friend. It's not the one Asian expert that you have. It is the multiplicity. Yeah. And also, how we also will disagree with each other in some of that aspect. And I think that complexity can build into it. I over-exaggerate the exhaustion. I think that is, but it is one of those things where it is also because I have had mentors who have been doing this for even before I was born. And it is because of their generosity and them taking me under their wing and actually continuing to give me life that I can actually continue to do this. But I appreciate the interest and the question, but it has to be, I respond in kind. And if you come, Pia?
I think it's, two things. I think part of it is, having those conversations. We're all going to end with figuring out what we're doing next, but having those conversations and then, figuring out what you're doing next and how those conversations are actually leading to change, even if that's just additional conversation. And I think the thing that I've run into, especially over the last few months, is I've been asked by quite a few people to speak on behalf of other people of color, and like Sixto said, all the experiences are different. And I think it has been that for me, that is a point of frustration. I can't speak for anybody else. I can speak for myself. I can speak for what my views represent. But I think it's about having as many conversations as possible and also accepting, again, like Sixto said, that everyone's viewpoint is different and everyone has different experiences. Even two Indian Americans might have really different experiences of being in this country or working in the arts or, with other qualifiers that make them seem at the surface very similar.
I would even say that my sisters would have a completely different experience living in the same household and growing up into it. And so our impressions are going to be different. But I think one more question. Last question.
All right. Hi, I'm Charlie Zong. And so I've listened throughout this panel and I've heard a lot of discussion on audience engagement. I really particularly appreciated the point about how it's not only important to portray a group accurately, but also to consult with the group. And so I think Stephen mentioned at one point that there's a generation gap and it's pretty pervasive. And so there are different issues unique to each generation, especially of Asian Americans, how that's particularly prominent in our community and how just like audiences want different things, generations may also want different things. And so I suppose what I realized was perhaps not only does the dialogue matter in participants, but also their specific kind of forum. And so right now we're having this conversation in a very broad forum, but there's also conversations that happen in a very narrow forum. For example, during the film festival, we're going to have a discussion mostly involving Asians, talking to Asians. And so therefore we run the risk of, for example, having a question or that's answered, but then nobody hears the answer. And the voices that don't get to be heard usually don't hear the answer, so they don't feel empowered. And then the wider community also doesn't hear the answer, as then they don't receive that perspective. But then if we have too broad of a forum, then what happens is I feel like a lot of disadvantaged voices have a harder time being heard. And so I'm actually a high school student, and so my passion is to engage youth, and especially to build forums, especially in the creative field. And so I hope that one day we will not have to turn away any questions. And so my question is, with the idea of the balancing act, do we want a forum in itself that's more focused, or do we want a forum that's more broad? Where's the balance? And especially, how do we balance not only the mainstream or I suppose like the particular group's perspective. Also, how do we balance across generations?
Good question. I do think that, one of the things, one of several things, action items we're going to take at HTO, as I mentioned, an advisory panel on these subjects, and I think making sure that all ages are represented on that advisory panel is very, very important. And I think that's going to be one of the big outcomes of this conversation. And we're looking forward even to continuing this conversation with Eileen Morris at the Ensemble Theater in the fall, I guess it is. Yeah. And so, you know, we're going to take on some of your ideas for that forum in the fall. But that's just our organization. There are others who can answer that.
In my personal opinion, I think you need both and everything in between. I know it's tiring, I know it's exhausting, but I think it's necessary. So you need those specific ones that reach a specific community, but also the ones that reach a broader audience as well. You don't want to miss a certain group of people to feel like they're going to be left out or they don't get to hear what your opinions are. So if you're motivated and you have the energy, I would encourage you to do that, starting with your own family, honestly, with your own parents and siblings, and branch out. Be uncomfortable. Like, that's the biggest thing this whole panel to me is about, is being uncomfortable and embracing that uncomfortableness.
And I would say you should keep going. You personally should keep going to talks like this and asking panelists questions like the ones that you asked, because it pushes us too.
Absolutely.
And I don't think you're going to do it all, because there are so many of us to do it.
Thank you very much. And so I'm now going to turn to just this last, actually we have time because of the live stream. We're going to leave it to our panelists. The question is, what are you doing personally or organizationally in order to make sure that this conversation, which if it's going to happen a year from now, sounds, looks, or is different? Speedo.
anyone who knows me on a personal level knows how important race is to me in any conversation. And I've been lucky enough to have a little bit of exposure last year by releasing a book about how I got to where I'm at right now. And how race has been extremely important, not in both good and bad ways, in my upbringing. And I think for me, it's even at a young age, lucky enough, I was lucky enough to have a parent who, with every project that I had to do, with every paper I had to write, my mom always made me do it about a person of color, and specifically African American. So at a young age, in fourth grade, fifth grade, whenever I had a project to write about, a war something or American something, my mother said, make it a black person. Make sure that it's a black, because you're not only going to educate yourself, you're going to educate others. And I think it starts, you know, I just saw, you know, high school or standing right here and asked these amazing questions. The next time you have a report or a paper or something you need to write on, educate your classmates on your culture, on where you come from, on who people important to your ethnic background. Because maybe every day we're taught about white people every day. Every day, from the moment you open your eyes to the moment you go to sleep, you're taught about something that's white. And I think it's important to give 5 minutes out of the day to something that looks like you. And not only not only to look like you, but to share that love and that amazingness and that beauty with other people.
Kia,
what's the name of your book?
It's called Sing for Your Life.
I think professionally, I'm excited to be in a position where we're able to give voices to artists and creators that may not otherwise be able to share their voice in Houston. So I think continuing to push that boundary will change the conversation. I'm hopeful. I would say personally, with the same intent, I am dedicated to the same intent of, you know, sort of sharing my experience, is pushing myself to get involved in interests that are outside of my own identity, so I can share my identity and have an exchange with someone, you know, outside of an Asian community or an Indian community, who feels like they have a similar background or a similar disadvantage or issue or conversation that they want to have. so that that expands my, because I have to do the work too, right? It's like being an Indian American on the stage does not give me any free pass. Like, I have growing to do as well.
Well, in addition to what I've already mentioned, the advisory panel, our work in HTOCO has been nearly 10 years now and has had a fantastic track record of community engagement and a really, really diverse set of works that mirror a very diverse community, and I think we always have to be better at that. And I hope that a year from now I'll be able to announce things that are that go further and continue to push the boundaries of what opera is.
A year from now, I hope that we don't start our conversation about what's different, our differences, but talk about our similarities. Because I will share we have the similar, we have the organ, we have the skin, and everything. There are a lot more similar experiences we have, and then we can share the empathy among us.
Patrick, you already mentioned the work that HTOCO is doing, and OC is going to be very involved with that. Very excited to, you know, target more Asian Americans to be exposed to the arts. Other than that, I want to increase the conversations between generations. I know that Charlie mentioned that. That to me is a key thing. We talked about a lot about what the artistic organizations can do, but also it's on us as Asian Americans, the parents, the children who are still growing. It's on us to recognize that this is a field to go down, possibly, and expose that it's a great path to go down. There's going to be risks, but there's going to be risks for any profession. That's just life. And if this kid truly loves what he or she wants to do in the arts, let them explore it. You know, don't diminish it. Mm-hmm. Let them explore that option. And that's what I want to encourage more parents and children to have more conversations about that topic.
So I don't get a pass, the things that I'm doing. I am going to actually accept vulnerability and actually write these opinions down on paper, and then so that you all can actually troll me and then all my ideas.
That's brave.
Yeah. The second is make sure that I'm not the person that they talk to and actually the go-to person as the moderator, that there needs to be another Asian voice that they can go to. And sir, where are you? We're going to talk. Like the high school who's, there you are. We need to talk because you might be here in a month. So thank you all very much to our panelists. Thank you all very much for your attention, your generosity, and for being here. And I look forward to seeing what work that you all are doing in order to make sure that this conversation changes in a year, within the next year. So thank you all. And thank you, Asian Society and HGO and OCA and everybody who, in order to make this happen. And thank you, HowlRound. And done, exactly on time.
Thank you very much. Now I can say thank you.